For the benefits of posterity, it's my pleasure today to welcome Leda Cosmides. For those of you who are thinking about using this as a talk to write up, Leda's kindly provided a couple of annual reviews articles that'll give you a good take into writing that up as well. She's just done a workshop for us, which was very kind, so I'm amazed she's still standing, but full of energy and a very exciting talk. We walked across from the hotel today past a little plaque, recognizing the fact that Darwin did a year of medicine here before deciding to go off and discover evolution, which has led over the last 100 years to what you're going to talk about today, which is the lively and vibrant science of evolutionary psychology. And I think we're in very good hands to take over from that and an excellent visit. I'm going to go and find a place to sit, which thank you again for coming in this packed room, and you can hear someone actually talking about something interesting. And yes, why not welcome our guest? Thank you.
And thank you so much for having me. It's, for me, it's particularly exciting because, you know, I'm here at the birthplace of the Enlightenment, for God's sakes. That's so great, and an idea that really should be tried someday. So thank you very much for having me. What I'm going to do is, first I want to talk a little bit about evolutionary psychology in general, and then I'm going to give a specific example from a research program that my colleagues and I have been involved in for far too long about cognitive adaptations for social exchange. So in the final pages of The Origin of Species, after Darwin had presented the theory of evolution by natural selection, he made a very bold prediction. He said, "In the distant future, I see open fields for far more important researches. Psychology will be based on a new foundation, that of the necessary acquirement of each mental power and capacity by gradation." Well, more than a century later, a group of scientists, John Tooby, myself, Martin Daly, Margot Wilson, Don Simons, David Buss, Steve Pinker, began to try to work out exactly how Darwin's fundamental insights could be used as a foundation on which to build a more systematic approach to psychology. And we were motivated by new developments from a series of different fields. The first was the cognitive revolution, which provided a very precise language for describing mental mechanisms as programs that process information. There were advances in paleoanthropology, hunter-gatherer studies, and primatology, which were providing data about the adaptive problems our ancestors had to solve to be able to survive and reproduce, and the environments in which they did so. There was research in animal behavior, linguistics and neuropsychology, that was showing that the mind is not a blank slate passively recording the world. Organisms come factory equipped, if you will, with knowledge about the world, which allows them to learn some relationships easily and others only with great effort, if at all. So Skinner's hypothesis that learning is a very simple process, simple general unitary process governed by reward and punishment, was simply wrong. And the fourth was evolutionary game theory, or the revolution that placed evolutionary biology on a more rigorous and formal foundation of replicator dynamics, which clarified how natural selection works, what counts as an adaptive function as opposed to other kinds of functions, and what the criteria are for calling a trait an adaptation. Some of these were present for ethology and sociobiology. It was the cognitive revolution that I think was a missing key and not available to people who were trying to do this kind of synthesis before. We thought that if one were really careful about the causal connections between these disciplines, that these new developments could be pieced together into a single integrated research framework in a way that hadn't been exploited before because the connections ran between fields rather than cleanly within any field. We called this framework evolutionary psychology. The goal of research in evolutionary psychology is to discover, understand, and map in detail the design of the human mind, as well as to explore the implications of those new discoveries for other fields. The eventual aim is to map human nature, and by human nature, I mean the species typical information processing architecture of the human brain. So like all cognitive scientists, when evolutionary psychologists refer to the mind, They mean the set of information processing devices embodied in neural tissue that are responsible for all conscious and non-conscious mental activity and that generate all behavior. And like other psychologists, evolutionary psychologists test hypotheses about the design of these information processing devices, these programs, using laboratory methods from experimental cognitive and social psychology, developmental psychology, as well as methods drawn from experimental economics, neuropsychology, and cross-cultural fieldwork. What allows evolutionary psychologists to go beyond traditional approaches in studying the mind is that they make use in the research, active use of an often overlooked fact that the programs comprising the human mind were designed by natural selection to solve adaptive problems faced by our hunter-gatherer ancestors. Problems like finding a mate, cooperating with others, hunting, gathering, protecting children, avoiding predators, problems like that. Natural selection tends to produce programs that solve problems like these quickly and efficiently. Knowing this allows one to approach the study of the mind like an engineer, or if you're familiar with David Marr's view of levels of explanation, theories of the computation, you first start with a good specification of an adaptive information processing problem. Then you do a task analysis of that problem. You ask, what kinds of features would a program that's really good at solving that problem need to have? That allows you to see what properties a program would have to have in order to solve the problem well, and that allows you to generate testable hypotheses about the structure of the programs that comprise the mind, and perhaps find evidence of programs that nobody would otherwise have thought to look for before. So from this point of view, there are very precise causal connections that link the four developments that I was just telling you about into a coherent framework for thinking about human nature and society. First, each organ of the body evolved to serve a function. The intestines digest, the heart pumps blood, the liver detoxifies poisons. The brain is also an organ, of course, and its evolved function, stated at its most general level, is to extract information from the environment and use that information to generate behavior and regulate physiology. From that perspective, the brain is a computer. That is, it's a physical system that was designed to process information. It has a different architecture than the computer I'm using, but that's what it does. Its programs were designed not by an engineer, but by natural selection, which is a causal process that retains and discards design features on the basis of how well they solved problems that affect reproduction. Now, the fact that the brain processes information is not an accidental side effect of some metabolic process. The brain was designed by natural selection to be a computer. Therefore, if you want to describe its operation in a way that captures its evolved function, you need to think of it as composed of programs that process information. So the question then becomes, what programs can be found in the human brain? What are the reliably developing species-typical programs that, taken together, comprise the human mind? Second, individual behavior is generated by this evolved computer in response to information that it extracts from the internal and external environment, including the social environment. To understand an individual behavior, therefore, you need to know both the information that the person registered and the structure of the programs that generated his or her behavior. You can't know just the information. I mean, dung flies respond to the smell of dung. We respond to the smell of dung. We withdraw from it. Dung flies fly to it, lay their eggs in it, look for mates at it. The information is there for both species, but how we react to it is structured by the different programs in our minds and the dung flies. Third, the programs that comprise the human brain were sculpted over evolutionary time by the ancestral environments and selection pressures experienced by the hunter-gatherers from whom we are descended. Each evolved program exists because it produced behavior that promoted the survival and reproduction of our ancestors better than alternative programs that arose during human evolutionary history. The reason evolutionary psychologists emphasize hunter-gatherer life is because the evolutionary process is really slow. It takes thousands of years to build a program of any complexity. And by complexity, I'm talking about something that has a lot of parts that have to fit together right to work. So if you think about the eye, and you think about the rods and cones of the retina, and you think about the shape of the surface and the fact that we have transparent proteins on the front of the eye and the curvature of the cornea and the iris ability to open and close with respect to light. Those are all parts that have to be, they're very precisely engineered, and they have to fit together in just the right way. That's what I mean when I'm talking about a program, a complex program. Things that are just quantitative variation can be pushed around, like average height and things like that, very easily by selection over shorter periods of time. But to build a program of that's complex and required many fixations for all the parts to be there, that's something that takes a lot of generations to evolve. And so when you think about it that way, the Industrial Revolution or even the Agricultural Revolution are eye blinks in evolutionary time. They're too short to have selected for just completely new cognitive programs that are complex and designed for those kinds of environments. Fourth, although the behavior that our evolved programs generate would, on average, have been adaptive, by that I mean reproduction promoting, in ancestral environments, in the ancestral environments that selected for their design, there's no guarantee that it'll be adaptive now. Modern environments differ in very important ways from ancestral ones, and that's particularly true when it comes to social behavior. We no longer live in small face-to-face societies in semi-nomadic bands of, you know, maybe 50 to 200 people, many of whom were close relatives. Yet our cognitive programs were designed for that social world, not the modern one. I probably saw more people this morning than the typical hunter-gatherer might have seen in a lifetime. It's a very different social world that we live in right now. Fifth, and perhaps most importantly, you should expect it to be comprised of many different programs, each specialized for solving a different adaptive problem that our ancestors faced. That is, you shouldn't expect the mind to be a blank slate. In fact, I would argue that the same is true for any computationally powerful multitasking computer. Consider whatever computer you use. I mean, so many people analyze data and also write prose that most computers come with a spreadsheet and a text editor. Those are two separate programs, each with different computational properties. And that's because number crunching and writing prose are very different problems. The design features that make a program good at analyzing data are not well suited for writing and editing articles, and vice versa. You would be in a special kind of hell if you were trying to write a paper in Excel or SPSS or R, and it would be horrible. And vice versa, if you were trying to you couldn't do the calculations in a word processing program. To accomplish both tasks well, the computer has two different programs, each well designed for a specific task. And the more functionally specialized programs it has, the more intelligent your computer is, the more things it can do. Just like having more apps on your cell phone makes your cell phone able to do many, many more things. And I would argue that the same is true for people, for our brains. You can think of our hunter-gatherer ancestors as having been, in effect, on a camping trip that lasted an entire lifetime. And they had to solve many different kinds of problems well to survive and reproduce under those conditions. Design features that make a program good at choosing nutritious foods, for example, would be ill-suited for finding a fertile mate. I'm married to John Tooby, my husband and collaborator. I would be married to a huge dark chocolate bar if I was using the same programs for choosing food and choosing mates. Just the desiderata for a mate and food are different. Different problems require different evolved solutions. That can be seen most clearly by using results from evolutionary game theory and data about ancestral environments to define adaptive problems, and then carefully dissecting the computational requirements of any program that's capable of solving those problems. So for example, as I'll show you in a few minutes, programs that might be well designed for logical reasoning are actually poorly designed for detecting cheaters in situations of social exchange and vice versa. And I'll show you data suggesting that we have programs that are functionally specialized for reasoning about reciprocity and exchange. Lastly, if you want to understand human culture and society, you need to understand these domain-specific programs in addition to whatever more domain-general programs exist in the mind. The mind is not like a video camera that just passively records the world but imparts no content of its own. Domain-specific programs organize our experiences, they create our inferences, they inject certain recurrent concepts and motivations into our mental life, they give us our passions, they provide some cross-culturally universal frames of meaning that allow us to understand the actions and intentions of others. They cause us sometimes to think very specific thoughts, to take certain ideas, feelings, and reactions to make them seem reasonable, interesting, and memorable. Consequently, they play a key role in determining which ideas and customs are going to easily spread from mind to mind, and which will spread only with difficulty. That is, they play a critical role, a crucial role in shaping human culture. Now, often people treat instincts and instinct is an old term, but I'll use it for time being. Instincts and reasoning as the opposite, as a diametric opposite of one another. In fact, sometimes people will say, "Oh, what evolution did was it erased instincts from the human mind and replaced it with the capacity for culture," without saying what that capacity is. But anyway, but the reasoning programs that evolutionary psychologists have been discovering have certain properties that people usually associate with an instinct. They seem to be complexly specialized for solving an adaptive problem. They reliably develop in all normal human beings. They develop without any conscious effort. They develop without any formal instruction. You don't need to go to school to learn them. They're applied without any awareness of their underlying logic. And they seem to be distinct from more general abilities to process information or behave intelligently. That is, they have all the hallmarks of what people often think of as an instinct. In fact, you can think of these specialized circuits as reasoning instincts. They make certain kinds of inferences just as easy, effortless, and natural to us as humans as spinning a web is to a spider or building a dam is to a beaver. My favorite example, a simple example to convey, comes from Simon Baron Cohen's work in Theory of Mind and specifically on the Charlie task. So you show any sensible 3-year-old or 4-year-old this display and you say, "This is my friend Charlie. Which candy does Charlie want?" And a neurotypical 3-year-old or 4-year-old will point to this one, say, "This is the one that Charlie wants." The one, they'll point to the one he's looking at. If you ask a person with autism the same question, their answers will be random. But the thing that's interesting about that is not just that their answers are random, but that when you ask them a different question, if you ask them, "Which candy is Charlie looking at?" people with autism will say, "This one." That means that they are correctly computing eye direction. They know what Charlie is looking at, but they don't use that information to make an inference about a mental state of wanting, an invisible thing that we can't actually see, the mental state. They don't make that inference. That's the kind that's what I mean by a reasoning instinct. And sometimes you can't see that. It seems so simple and straightforward any kind of life experience, if you have a domain general system, should figure something like that out, if it can figure it out at all, given that you can't see states like wanting, that eye direction is going to be a cue of that. Yet here are people who know the eye direction but don't make that inference. Sometimes it's cases of people that are not neurotypical that can awaken you to the existence of what I'm calling reasoning instincts. I think as a species, we've been blind to the existence of these instincts, not because we lack them, but precisely because they work so well. Because they process information so effortlessly and automatically, their operation sometimes disappears unnoticed into the background. They structure our thoughts so powerfully that it can be difficult to imagine how things could be otherwise. As a result, we often take so-called normal behavior for granted. We don't realize that normal behavior needs to be explained at all. For example, all of you probably take for granted the fact that by exchanging goods and services, people can make each other better off. Every time you go to a Starbucks and you give them money and they give you a mocha. But that kind of cooperation for mutual benefit, known in evolutionary biology as reciprocity or reciprocal altruism or more generally social exchange, is not common in the animal kingdom. Although it's zoologically rare, social exchange does seem to have evolved in some species, from vampire bats to certain primates, indicating that some species have evolved cognitive programs necessary for engaging in this behavior, while others have not. And so the research that John Tooby and I and our colleagues have been doing suggests that the programs that allow social exchange to proceed in humans are specialized for that function and include what you can think of as a subroutine that you can think of as an instinct that causes a certain kind of moral reasoning, the detection of cheaters. So we looked at social exchange because there was evidence that it's a long enduring adaptive problem. Social exchange behavior seems to be universal and highly elaborated across cultures, and it presents itself in a lot of different forms: reciprocal gift giving, food sharing, market pricing, and so on. You won't be dropped into a culture and find people not engaging in reciprocity relationships and some sort of trading of goods and favors. It doesn't seem to be a recent cultural invention, like writing or rice cultivation or computer programming. If it were a recent cultural invention, you would expect there to be a point of origin and evidence of it having spread by contact and being present in some cultures and absent in other cultures, like writing is. But there doesn't seem to be any evidence of any particular point of origin or spreading by contact, and you find it everywhere. There's paleoanthropological evidence suggesting from hunter-gatherer archaeology suggesting that it might be at least 2 million years old. And the fact that there are some forms of social exchange in some of our primate cousins suggests it might be even older than that. In other words, situations involving social exchange are ancient, pervasive, central part of human social life, and have constituted a long, engaging this behavior is a long enough enduring adaptive problem that you might expect to see cognitive mechanisms specialized for solving it to be present in the human brain. So to get more specific, let me define what I mean by a social contract as a situation in which one is obligated to satisfy a requirement of some kind, often at some cost to oneself, in order to be entitled to receive a benefit. The other person imposes a requirement because satisfying it creates a situation that benefits the party that imposed it. So for example, if I say to you, if you give me your watch, I'll give you $100. First of all, I wouldn't have made that offer unless I would prefer your watch to keeping my $100. And you would not accept it unless you preferred my $100 to keeping your watch. So a well-formed social contract expresses an intercontingent situation of mutual benefit. To receive a benefit, an individual or group is required to provide a benefit. So usually, but not always, one incurs a cost by satisfying that requirement, but that cost is outweighed by the benefit that you receive in return. So social exchange can be thought of as an I'll scratch your back if you scratch mine principle. Now, cheating is the violation of a social contract. A cheater is an individual who illicitly benefits him or herself by taking a benefit without having satisfied the requirement that the other party made that benefit contingent on. So I would have cheated you if I accepted your watch but did not give you the $100, and you would have cheated me if you accepted my $100 but you did not give me the watch. So notice something, this will be more important in a minute, but notice that when I say if you give me your watch, I'll give you $100, that's a general conditional statement. You can think of more abstractly as having the form if P then Q. The case where I cheated you is a case where P happened, you gave me your watch, and Q did not happen. Q is false. I didn't give you the money. And that happens to be the logically correct answer for any rule of the form if P then Q. If you're just applying first order logic to a rule of the form if P then Q, it's violated whenever P happens and Q doesn't happen. You would have cheated me if you accepted my $100, Q, and did not give me your watch, not P. That would be the correct answer, the correct thing if we're trying to find out, if the mind was trying to find out if you cheated me. But notice that that's not the logically correct answer. And social exchanges are not biconditionals, if you were thinking about that, but I could talk about that in a minute. So Natural selection can design programs that cause us to deliver benefits to people who are unrelated to us, provided that there's sufficient probability that the favor is going to be reciprocated. If I had circuits that caused me to constantly deliver benefits to you regardless of whether you ever reciprocated the favor, then the circuits causing me to behave in that way would eventually be selected out, because I would constantly be incurring costs to benefit you, and nothing would be happening that outweighs those costs. So any design that results in my consistently being cheated would be selected out. So for that reason, evolution is not going to sustain, natural selection is not going to select for programs that make us want to deliver benefits to others unless those programs also include circuits that are good at detecting the possibility of cheating. And the work I want to show you is investigating whether such circuits, there's evidence for such circuits at all. So notice that reciprocation is, by definition, it's social behavior that's conditional. You deliver a benefit conditionally. That is conditional on the other person doing what you required in return. Understanding it, you could then think, involves some form, requires conditional reasoning of some kind. So investigations of conditional reasoning can serve as a test case. You can ask, well, what kind of reasoning instincts govern how we think about social exchange? Well, formal logic has rules for conditional reasoning, the propositional calculus, first-order logic more generally. And you could ask the question, in reasoning about social exchange, does the human mind apply reasoning procedures that embody formal logic, procedures that are domain-general and content-free, that apply no matter what the subject matter is? Or are there reasoning procedures that are specialized for social exchange that might be domain-specific and content-rich? More generally, you can ask, is the cognitive machinery that causes good conditional reasoning general, does it operate well regardless of content, a more blank slate type theory, or do our minds include cognitive machinery that's specialized for reasoning about social exchange, alongside whatever other domain-specific mechanisms might exist, specialized for reasoning about other adaptive problems? So in this work, we used the Wason selection task, the task developed by Peter Wason. He developed it as a test of conditional reasoning, and we used it to test a lot of hypotheses. So let me first show you a Wason selection task. I'll read it out loud for you. This one has nothing to do with social exchange or social contracts. It's just a descriptive rule. Ebbinghaus disease was recently identified and is not yet well understood. So an international committee of physicians who have experience with disease was assembled. Their goal was to characterize the symptoms and develop surefire ways of diagnosing it. Patients afflicted with Ebbinghaus disease have many different symptoms, nosebleeds, headaches, ringing in their ears, and others. Diagnosing it is difficult because a patient may have the disease, yet not manifest all of the symptoms. Dr. Buchner, an expert on the disease, said that the following rule holds. If a person has Ebbinghaus disease, then that person will be forgetful. Dr. Buchner may be wrong, however. You're interested in seeing whether there are any patients whose symptoms violate this rule. The cards below represent four patients in your hospital. Each card represents one patient. One side of the card tells whether or not the patient has Ebbinghaus disease, and the other side tells whether or not that patient is forgetful. Which of the following card or cards would you definitely need to turn over to see if any of these cases violate Dr. Buchner's rule? If a person has Ebbinghaus disease, then that person will be forgetful. Don't turn over any more cards than are absolutely necessary. So would you need to look at this guy? What if this guy was not forgetful? Would that violate the rule? That would violate the rule. What about this person? Would this person potentially violate the rule? No. Because it doesn't say that Ebbinghaus disease is the only thing that makes people forgetful. You know, you could have Alzheimer's disease, you could have the flu, you could be my age. There's lots of things that make you forgetful. It's saying that if you have Ebbinghaus disease, then you'll be forgetful. This one you don't need to turn over for the same reason. If it said has the flu, that can make you forgetful. And anything on the other side of this could be associated with this, and it wouldn't violate this rule. But what about this card? Do you need to look at this? Yes, and that's what most people don't realize. If this card says that this patient has Ebbinghaus disease, yet that person's not forgetful, that would be a case that violates the rule. Because remember, the question is asking you if any of the any of these cases violate the rule. It's not asking you to judge the rule as a whole. It's about any of these specific cases violating the rule. Well, this is a rule of the form if P then Q. And the logically correct response is, since the only thing that violates if P then Q is the combination of P and not Q, the logically correct response is to pick the P card, the not Q card, that is Q is false, Q didn't happen, P happens, Q not happens, that Q doesn't happen, that violates the rule. Pick P, not Q, and no other cards. But only 26% of undergraduates, for example, pick P and not Q and no other card. That does not make us the poster children for logical reasoning. The most common thing, and that's actually on the higher side. Often, if I gave you an abstract version of this rule, like if there's a vowel on one side, then there's an odd number on the other side, you'd do worse. I gave you one having to do with the idea that diseases cause symptoms, a familiar relationship from everyday life, and you know, anywhere from 4 to 25% is what you usually see on this kind of rule. The most common thing is to choose P alone or to choose P and Q. And the most common error is to not choose not Q. That's what people frequently forget. Now I'm going to show you a Weissmann selection task where the content is a social contract. Okay, teenagers who don't have their own cars usually end up borrowing their parents' cars. In return for the privilege of borrowing the car, the Goldsteins have given their kids the rule: if you borrow my car, then you have to fill up the tank with gas. Of course, teenagers are sometimes careless and irresponsible. You're interested in seeing whether any of the Goldstein teenagers broke this rule. The cards below represent four of the Goldstein teenagers. Each card represents one teenager. One side of the card tells whether or not a teenager has borrowed the parent's car on a particular day, and the other side tells whether or not that teenager filled up the tank with gas on that day. Which of the following card or cards would you definitely need to turn over to see if any of these teenagers are breaking their parents' rule? If you borrow my car, then you have to fill up the tank with gas. Don't turn over any more cards than are absolutely necessary. So here, what about this kid who borrowed the car? Do you have to look? Yeah. What about this one who didn't borrow the car? Do you need to look? No. They could be really nice to their parents. They could have filled up the tank with gas even though they didn't borrow the car. But they haven't violated the rule. They haven't cheated. They haven't violated the rule. Here's somebody who filled up the tank with gas. Do you have to check this person? No. Same reason. Here's somebody who did not fill up the tank with gas. Do you need to see if they borrow the car? Yeah. Lots of your heads are going like this. Now, even if you got the other one, did this one seem more obvious in some way to you? I'm guessing it did, because 76% of undergraduates will answer P, not Q, and no other cards on this one. That's a big difference. It's known as a big effect. So the claim that I'm going to give you evidence for is that the mind sees the problem in this way, that your mind is translating social contracts into representations of benefits and requirements, and your mind is inserting concepts like entitled to and obligated to, whether they're specified or not, that you hallucinate them in, even if it's not verbally specified. So that this rule, if you borrow my car, then you have to fill up the tank with gas, is translated into an underlying format. If you take the benefit, then you're obligated to satisfy the requirement. A cheater detection routine kicks in. It's looking for cases of individuals who took the benefit without meeting the requirement. And so it's investigating anybody who accepted the benefit to see if they did not satisfy the requirement, and anybody who did not satisfy the requirement to see if they accepted the benefit. That's the claim. And that will, by chance, correspond to the logical categories, true antecedent, or P, and false consequent, or Q, not Q. So the question was, do people have cognitive adaptations that are specialized for reasoning about social contracts? And in particular, do people have inference procedures that are specialized for cheater detection? So we approached the question by studying human reasoning, and there was already a large literature that showed that people are not very good at detecting violations of conditional rules, indicative conditional rules, ones describing the state of the world, or purporting to, even when those rules deal with familiar content drawn from everyday life. So to show that people who ordinarily cannot detect violations of conditional rules can suddenly do so when that violation represents cheating on a social contract would constitute at least initial evidence that people have reasoning procedures that are specialized for, specially designed for detecting cheaters in situations of social exchange. And then you, of course, have to look for other design features and rule out every alternative hypothesis that anybody has ever proposed. Okay. So what design features should these programs have? There's a lot of them, but I'll talk about just a few, that there should be mechanisms that are good at detecting cheaters. Familiarity of the rule should not be relevant, because I have to understand each new situation for exchange as it arises. I can't just understand the last thing that happens. I have to understand new opportunities that present themselves. It should embody an adaptive logic that does not correspond to something like first-order logic. Benefits and costs should be relevant. You need to be able to compute those things to even know whether you want to exchange it at all. That there should be a distinction, I'll explain later, between cheating and innocent mistakes, that the mind should be good at detecting cheaters, and that should be different than detecting whether cheating has happened by virtue of an innocent mistake, for example. The definition of cheating should depend on whose perspective you're taking, which person in the interaction's perspective you're taking, and there should be a robust cross-cultural development, especially of cheater detection. So let's go design feature by design feature. Familiarity should not be relevant. So in early experiments, the teenagers borrowing the car, you could say, oh, well, that's something people have experience with. Of course, people also have the experience of diseases causing symptoms, but you can have experience with that. So what we did was we created a fictitious culture and an insane rule. If a man eats cassava root, then he must have a tattoo on his face. We created various rules that were like that, on the assumption that no sophomore would have ever encountered this particular conditional rule. And then what we did was we varied the story surrounding that rule. We varied that context to change the interpretation of the rule. So in one case, we gave it a descriptive context. So the social contract context was like this. We said, there's these people, the Kalawami. They live on this island in Polynesia. And the Kalawami believe that cassava root is an aphrodisiac. Everybody wants to eat cassava root. Molo nuts are nasty and bitter. They're not so interested in molo nuts, but they really want to eat cassava root. And having a tattoo on your face among these people means that you're married. Having no tattoo means you're unmarried. The elders are concerned about sexual mores, and so they've made the rule, if a man eats cassava root, then he must have a tattoo on his face. There's four men sitting around the campfire. Each card below represents one man. One side tells whether or not he's eating cassava root. The other side tells whether or not he has a tattoo on his face. Which would you need to turn over to see if any of these men are violating the rule? Okay, that would be the social contract version. And so, of course, getting the benefit, the aphrodisiac, without having met the requirement, having no tattoo, that would be a case that violates the rule. And so you should pick the cassava root card, the no tattoo card, and not the other cards. Okay. The descriptive context made sense of it, but there's no rationed benefit that you get only by meeting a requirement. So it said, same thing, there's these people, the Kalawami, on this island in the Pacific. The Kalawami have two staple foods, cassava root and molo nuts. Having a tattoo on your face means you're married. Having no tattoo means you're unmarried. The cassava root happens to grow on the same side of the island where you hear people say, if a man eats cassava root, then he must have a tattoo on his face. You notice that cassava root grows on the same side of the island where the married men tend to live, and the molo nuts grow on the side of the island where unmarried men tend to live. And when you hear the people saying this, you're the anthropologist, you think, oh, maybe men are just eating the foods that are most available to them. Here are four men around the campfire. Which cards would you need to turn over to see if the behavior of any of these men violates this rule? So it's still an if P then Q rule, but it doesn't involve a social contract. It's just purporting to describe people's habits. So the question I'm going to ask is, what percentage of people are picking P, not Q, and no other card on this task, which happens to be the logically correct response? It's also, for the social contract, the correct response if you're looking to see if any of these men are cheating. So on the descriptive one, so percent P and not Q is on here. On the descriptive one, you get very typical performance, 21%, 25% correct. On the social contract, it goes up to 75, 71% correct. In fact, people are just as good on this weird social contract as they are on very familiar ones, like if you're drinking beer, then you have to be over 18 years old. So unfamiliar content, if it if it can be interpreted as a social exchange, as a social contract, it activates good cheater detection. Okay, but then you could think, well, maybe social contract content, maybe that just activates, for some reason, it activates logical reasoning, other problems don't, but let's say for some reason it does. Well, another design feature would be that there should be rules for reasoning about social contracts that are not equivalent to first order logic. So you can ask, does social contract content merely activate logical reasoning? So like the predicate calculus for first order logic. But notice that in logic, if P then Q does not imply if Q then P. I mean, so if I say if it's a horse, then it's an animal, that doesn't apply if it's an animal, it's a horse, for example. Or does it activate a logic peculiar to social exchange? In social exchange, if P then Q does imply if Q then P, but only if P is a ration benefit and Q is a requirement. So for example, it should be that if you take the benefit, then you're obligated to satisfy the requirement. It should be that from the point of view of your mind, that does imply that if you take the benefit, that if you satisfy the requirement, then you're entitled to take the benefit. That should be a natural inference that you make about a social contract. So what counts as cheating does not correspond to logical violation. So if I say, it doesn't matter, if I'm offering a deal to you, if I say to you, if you give me your watch, I'll give you $100, or if I say, if I give you $100 and give me your watch, I'm offering the exact same social contract to you. I'm not saying something different. At least the proposal is your mind doesn't hear that as something different. But from the point of view of logic, they're both statements of the form if P then Q. And all I've done is I've put the benefit to me, the potential cheater in this case, into the antecedent clause. And here it's in the consequent clause. But it doesn't matter about the case of me cheating you. I would have cheated you if you gave me your watch and I did not give you $100, regardless of how I said it. So this case, when I put the benefit to the potential cheater here, that corresponds to P and not Q, which is the logically correct response. But if what I said was, if I give you $100 and give me your watch, I've switched the positioning of the benefit to me to be Q, then you giving me your watch is Q, right? And me not giving you the money is not P, P not happening. And Q and not P is not a logically correct response. So what you can do is then you can just take the same rules as before and put the benefit into the consequent clause. So like if you have a tattoo on your face, then you eat cassava root, for example. We did problems like that. And the question is, now what percent of people are choosing Q and not P and no other cards? This is not a logically correct response and is a rare response on descriptive rules. When we do this with the descriptive version of the rule, almost nobody, this is nobody picking that. This is, you know, one person out of 25, something like that, picking that. And here's the percent picking that when it's a social contract. So here they are picking the response that is correct if you're looking for cheaters, and it is not correct if your mind was just applying first order logic to the surface structure of that rule. Because then you would say not P, and you would pick P and not Q. So it's not just that social contract content is activating logical reasoning. People's minds are perfectly willing to violate the rules of logic, like modus ponens and modus tollens, when it's a problem that would involve looking for cheaters. Does social contract reasoning dissociate from more general forms of reasoning? Vera Malkovich looked at people with schizophrenia and hospitalized controls. And people with schizophrenia have reasoning deficits in all kinds of reasoning, including various kinds of logical reasoning, like if John is taller than Nike and Nike is taller than Lita, then John is taller than Lita, something, you know, all kinds of rules of all kinds of logical reasoning they have problems with. And her subjects also had problems with these more general forms of reasoning. People with schizophrenia, these were people with positive symptoms of schizophrenia, they had no problem detecting cheaters on social contracts. They looked just like the hospitalized controls in doing that. So you could have big impairments in other kinds of reasoning and have preserved social contract reasoning. Another design feature, the definition of what counts as cheating should be depend on the perspective, which agent in the exchange you're talking about. This was done by Gerrit Gigerenzer and Klaus Hoog. They used a series of rules that are like this. If an employee is to get a pension, then he must have worked for the firm for over 10 years. Now, what counts as a violation depends on your perspective, and he cued different sets of subjects into different perspectives. So one set of subjects, he said, you're an employer, and you're worried about employee cheating on this rule. Employees cheating on this rule, which cards would you need to turn over to see if any of these employees violated the rule, to look for violations of the rule. The other group of subjects, so that would be a case of somebody who got the pension but worked less than 10 years, P and not Q, that happens to be logically correct. The other set of subjects, he said, you're an employee and you're worried that the employer may be cheating. Which cards would you need to turn over to see if the behavior of the employer violated this rule? In that case, an employee has been cheated by the employer if they worked for 10 years but did not get their pension. That's Q and not P, and that's not logically correct. So if you're looking at choices of P and not Q and Q and not P, when it's from the employer perspective, P and not Q should be high and Q and not P should be low. From the employee perspective, it should be the reverse. If it was just logical reasoning procedures and actually most other theories, you'd expect high levels of P and not Q on both, because it's exactly the same rule. It's the same social contract in both cases. So do we see an X or do we not? Here's what the results look like. You get a big X. What counts as cheating seems to be computed in a perspective-dependent way. There are no perspectives in logic. And performance was actually good from both perspectives. That's just the same thing. Well, then you could say, well, how domain-specific is the mechanism? Is it general to all deontic rules? Deontic rules are rules involving obligation, entitlement, or prohibition. So Cheng and Holyoak propose that there's a permission schema, and it's composed of four of these four rules. If the action is to be taken, then the precondition must be satisfied. If the action is not to be taken, then the precondition need not be satisfied. If the precondition is satisfied, then the action may be taken. If the precondition is not satisfied, then the action must not be taken. Now notice, taking a benefit is a case of taking an action, but not all actions that you take are necessarily benefits. So for example, there used to be a rule at UCSB when I first got there, before the internet and before everything was being done electronically. There was this rule that said, if you write an inter-office memo, then it must be on blue paper. I don't know why. I don't know if it benefits anybody. I don't know what. But writing an inter-office memo is not a benefit in particular to anybody, and it's just a weird rule. There are permission rules, or you know, if you eat salad, use this fork. Or there's a lot of rules that are permission rules that are not necessarily social contracts. So social contracts regulate access to benefits. And all social contracts are permission rules, but not all permission rules are social contracts. Some are not. So we can test this by varying whether the rule regulates access to a benefit. So benefits, because benefits should matter. So again, this was a context of fictitious culture in which the elders have made laws governing what teenagers are allowed to do. And all of these rules fit that permission rule template. If one is to take action A, then one must satisfy precondition R. So this first one, to college students, if one is going out at night, then one must tie a small piece of red volcanic rock around one's ankle. College students going out at night, great. Sex, drugs, and rock and roll, it's a benefit. And it's easily interpreted as a benefit that adults are rationing all the time. The second condition, it changes just two words. Going out at night becomes staying home at night. Most people don't think of staying home at night as some benefit that you have to meet some requirement in order to do. And then we try to make it worse by saying if one's taking out the garbage, then one must tie a small piece of red volcanic rock around one's ankle. Notice that these all have this format. But only this one should be interpreted as a social contract, because only that one regulates what people would naturally interpret it as access to a benefit or a privilege. So what happens to reasoning performance on these three rules? They're at 80% on the one going out at night. This is staying home. This is taking out the garbage. Performance is dropping a lot when you take out the benefit, even though they're all permission rules. It should be like this if permission schema theory were correct. This is Sears problem about a store called Sears. It's a more everyday problem. It's showing the same pattern of results, same kind of problem, same kind of design. So how domain-specific is the mechanism? It doesn't detect violations of all permission rules or all deontic rules or all social norms. These benefit results rule out permission schema theory and all kinds of deontic theories of reasoning. Wait a second. Something's missing. Okay. I'm missing a slide. Okay. Forget about that. So another design feature should be, it matters whether you're looking for cheaters or looking for innocent mistakes. The problem from the point of view of evolutionary game theory is avoiding individuals with a disposition to cheat. Everybody is going to fail to reciprocate at some point in time. You may be a great cooperator, and you may have forgotten that I need help, or you may have forgotten to do something you said you'd do for me, or you may have not found food today and be unable to help me today, or all kinds of things can happen in life that make you unable to reciprocate, even though you are good, your disposition is to cooperate with me. If I were a tit-for-tat kind of decision rule that ruled you out whenever you fail to reciprocate, no matter what the reason, pretty soon I'd have nobody to cooperate with because everybody's going to fail sometimes to reciprocate. So it should be an important design feature that the mechanism is looking for individuals with a disposition to cheat, not just for events in which somebody has been cheated, where somebody has not gotten what they were entitled to. So we were looking for that design feature, cheating versus innocent mistakes. Is the mechanism designed to look for cheaters, individuals with a disposition to cheat, or events in which a social contract's been violated, cases in which someone has been cheated? Just what I said before. Something got out of order, I don't know how. So in this series of experiments, this intentionality series, we used exactly the same social contract rule in all conditions. It was a deontic permission rule involving utilities. So it was a permission rule of the kind that I just showed you. It involved benefits and requirements. And a violation was always an event where one party had been cheated. They didn't get what they were aiming for by imposing the rule. And we varied the benefit to the potential violator. Would the potential violator get the benefit stated in the rule or not? Did they intend to violate? Or are they making an innocent mistake? And in the second set of the series, their ability to violate. What were their procedures, countermeasures in place to try to prevent cheating from happening? Because if there are, the search for cheaters is unlikely to reveal individuals with the disposition to cheat because the situation makes cheating difficult. So first set was, social contract rule was, if a student is to be assigned to Dover High School, then that student must live in Dover City. And the context explains that Dover High is a really, really good school. Hanover High is not a very good school. The people living in Dover City pay high taxes to support this really good school. People living in Hanover and these other cities around are just as prosperous as the people in Dover City, but they don't pay the taxes to support the schools, high taxes. The Board of Education took these factors into account when creating this rule. If a student is to be assigned to Dover High School, which is, the benefit, then that student must live in Dover City. And you supervise volunteers at the Board of Education who are sorting students' documents and are supposed to be sorting them using this rule. So notice that the Board of Education hasn't got what it wants. If you need to check the person who is assigned to Dover High School, because if they live in like the town of Hanover, that would violate the rule. And a person in the town of Hanover who got sorted to Dover City, again, there that would be a violation of the rule. What we varied was, so we kept the social contract identical. The interpretation is identical in all conditions. What we varied were properties of the potential rule violators. So in the cheater condition, it's mothers with high school age children who have volunteered to sort documents at the local Board of Education. And in the context that some may have sorted their own children's documents and may have cheated, which would you need to turn over, documents would you need to turn over to see if any of these violate the rule. So that's a case where they it's implied that they intend to violate the rule, and they would get the benefit specified in the rule by doing so. In the sabotage condition, it says the people who are supposed to be sorting the documents are women who are mad at you for having fired their best friend. They intend to violate the rule because they want to make chaos that's going to make you look incompetent in the eyes of your boss. So in the sabotage condition, they have the intention to violate, but they're not getting the benefit specified in the rule. They may get the pleasure of messing you up with your boss, but they're not getting the benefit of a child into Dover High School by the benefit regulated by the social contract. And in the innocent mistake condition, you're told that the volunteers are, they're absent-minded elderly ladies who work at the Board of Education, and some of them may have made mistakes. And see, which documents would you need to know to see if any of them violate the rule? So same social contract, properties of the violators are varied. Here's what happens. In the cheating condition, you get the full social contract response. Sabotage condition, down by 20 points. Mistake condition, another 20 points. We then did this a full parametric design where we varied benefit present versus absent, intention present versus absent, and then in this one we also did ability present versus absent. So does the situation, like in that one it didn't say anything about countermeasures, so violating might be easy, or are there anti-cheating measures in place, like the documents are redacted? Here's what you get. When you have the benefit, the intention, and the ability to cheat, you get the full response. If you take away any one of those but leave the other two properties, it drops by 20 points. And if you take away two of those key things, it drops by another 20 points to the same level as when none of those things are present. So each cue, getting the benefit, the intention to violate the rule, and the ability, the situation making it possible to violate the rule, seems to independently and additively contribute to activation of this system. The results rule out all deontic counter theories and every theory that depends on the interpretation of the rule, per se. It rules out general skill acquisition or utility-based theories, because surely a lifetime of cases of not getting what you're entitled to should make you good at looking for cases where somebody doesn't get what they're entitled to. But here, even if it's an innocent mistake, the Board of Education is not getting what they want, but your mind's only detecting violations when that would reveal people who are potential cheaters. Let me go forget about all that. So it's cheating by design. Mechanisms looking for cheating by design, not cheating by mistake. Functionally specialized to look for cheaters, individuals with a disposition to cheat. So how specialized is this mechanism? It's so specialized, even I sometimes am freaked out. Okay, to not torment you too much, I'm going to go a little bit, a little bit faster. Another kind of problem that people do very well on are precautionary problems that have the form, if you engage in a hazardous activity, then you must take the precaution. Like if you work with toxic gases, then you have to wear a gas mask. And people are good at picking the engage in hazardous activity card and don't take the precaution card, P and not Q. They elicit good violation detection. Again, you can ask how domain-specific is the mechanism, because all social contracts are permission rules, all precautionary rules are permission rules. There are permission rules that are neither social contracts nor precautions, which you already saw don't elicit good violation detection. Social contracts regulate access to benefits. Precautionary rules say what you should do to avoid harm. And you can ask, is reasoning about both of these domains governed by one mechanism or two? Now, we already know from other research that there are functional dissociations, so that I just told you about how intention to violate versus innocent mistake makes a difference for cheater detection. If you do that same experiment with precautionary rules, it makes no difference. And that's what you would expect if the function of precautionary rules is to detect when people are in danger, because you're in just as much danger if you don't wear the gas mask, whether you did it on purpose or accidentally. You're in just as much danger. And so there is that functional dissociation, and there are other functional dissociations. We actually looked at a guy with brain damage. A single mechanism account predicts that brain damage affecting social contract reasoning will also affect precautionary reasoning and vice versa. But a two mechanism account says that a neural dissociation is at least possible. So Valerie Stone had a patient, RM, who ironically had brain damage by not wearing a bicycle helmet when he went bicycling. And he had, actually from my point of view, I don't care about the particular pattern of damage, but he had bilateral orbital frontal damage, damage to both anterior temporal lobes, and so much so that his amygdala were disconnected from his temporal lobes. And he reasoned completely normally on the precautionary rules. We had matching sets, but he had a lot of difficulty detecting cheaters on social contracts. So here are control subjects who do equally well on both sets of problems, and here's RM with a whopping 31 percentage point difference between the two. And it's not just that having a lot of brain damage for some reason hurts your ability to reason about social contracts, because there's other patients with even more brain damage, not exactly the same pattern, who have no difference in their reasoning about social contracts and precautionary rules. But he has this huge difference. We've also done a number of labs now, have done fMRI studies of social contracts and precautionary rules, and found different patterns of activation for them as well. Last kind of data, does the cheater detection subroutine develop cross-culturally? Well, you find the same pattern of reasoning responses in the industrialized world, across the industrialized world. But you can ask, well, what about non-industrial societies? So one of our former graduate students, Larry Sugiyama, who's now a professor at University of Oregon, he was studying Chivar, hunter horticulturalist in the Ecuadorian Amazon. And what we did was we adapted the task for a non-literate, non-Western population. And while you can't test every culture that's ever existed on Earth, you can, because some don't exist anymore, can't test ancient Greece, there's a lot of places you can't test. But what you can do is go somewhere that's as different on as many dimensions as possible as, say, Santa Barbara. So the Chivar live in a very, this is the region. These are villages that you can see cut into the rainforest. This is a Chivar gentleman in his hut. There's no place people that are uncontacted by people from the West on Earth, but it was a long time before the people, Chivar and Chuar people, were contacted because, the rivers are not navigable most of the year, and so it's very hard to get there. In fact, often anthropologists have to be airdropped in there to find them. Without belaboring the details, we created a version of the task that, with photographs and windows that you can open and close, like turning cards over. And then the question is, when it comes to picking the cheater-relevant cards, benefit accepted, we gave them a standard social contract, a switch social contract, the kind where Q and not P is the correct answer, and a descriptive rule. And the question is, what do they look like when we look at the cheater-relevant cards, the benefit accepted card and the requirement not met card? What do they look like compared to Harvard undergraduates? And that's your answer. The Chivar in blue, the Harvard undergraduates are in yellow. The benefit accepted card is P for one of the rules, it's Q for the other rule, the switched rule, the requirement not met is not Q for the standard version of the rule, not P for the switched rule. They're exactly the same. Now, that doesn't mean they're completely the same, because sometimes the Chivar actually expressed interest in people who might have been generous. So with the rule, if you bring me a basket of fish, then you can use my motorboat. Some of them said, hey, this guy who brought the basket of fish, maybe he didn't borrow the motorboat, because maybe it's the guy's brother, and so on and so forth. But you can ask the question, well, are Chivar just doing so well because they're choosing all four cards equally likely? Or are they showing the pattern of more likely to choose the cards that are relevant to detecting cheaters? And so since we had standard and switch rules, we can hold the logical category constant and vary whether the card is cheater relevant or not. So here what you're seeing is, so P is benefit accepted for the standard rule, but P is the requirement met for the switched rule. Not Q is the requirement not met for the standard version of the rule, and it's the benefit not accepted for the other rule, for the switched rule. And what you're seeing here is holding logical category constant, they are always choosing the card more frequently when it is the cheater relevant card than it when it's not the cheater relevant card, when it's not relevant to cheater detection. So adaptations are aspects of the phenotype that were designed by natural selection. What counts as evidence? To show that an aspect of the phenotype is an adaptation, you need to produce evidence that it's well designed for solving an adaptive problem that the species faced in the past. For example, in this case, cognitive procedures that are adaptations for detecting cheaters, you want to show that these procedures are well designed for detecting cheaters on social contracts. And you also have to show that their design features are not more parsimoniously explained as byproducts of cognitive processes that evolved to solve some other kind of problem or more general class of problem. So evidence of special design, the cognitive programs governing reasoning about social contracts that these are all predicted in advance. They operate even in unfamiliar situations. They embody implicational procedures specified by the theory that we worked out involving concepts of obligation, entitlement, as you saw with switched social contracts. They have procedures specialized for cheater detection. These procedures are neurally dissociable. They're found cross-culturally. The definition of cheating they embody is content-dependent. It's accepting a benefit without satisfying the requirement. The definition is perspective-dependent. They cannot detect violations of social contracts that are unlikely to reveal a cheater, like no innocent mistakes, not with innocent mistakes. They don't operate in the same way unless you've got the cost-benefit structure of a social contract. When you take away the benefit, the effect goes away. They're just as good at detecting what counts as cheating from one perspective as the other one. It turns out Paul Harris and Maria Nunez have evidence of precocial competence for cheater detection in 3- and 4-year-olds. And I didn't show it, but when we do the same thing, asking people to look for altruists, they're not particularly, Western subjects are not particularly good at detecting altruists, but they're good at detecting cheaters. Eliminated a lot of byproduct hypothesis. Familiarity alone cannot explain the effects we found. The application of first-order logic cannot explain those effects. A content-independent deontic logic cannot explain the effects that we found. Social contract content doesn't merely afford clear thinking. You saw that especially with the innocent mistakes. The same rule, same content, different performance. This would be a whole talk itself about relevance theory. It can't explain what we found. And the mere presence of payoffs does not by itself elicit the detection of violations. That is, there's no content-independent, domain-general, blank slate-type theory that I know of, at least, that can explain the social contract effects. So what it looks like to us is that the human mind contains a neurocognitive adaptation that's functionally specialized for reasoning about social exchange, which includes a subroutine for detecting cheaters. And this neurocognitive system reliably develops in the human cognitive architecture in what looks to be a species-typical manner. I would say it's a component of human nature. So thank you for your patience.